My Lord, my guide, who gives me peace of mind, my only hope in these uncertain times, even when I feel I'm not all I should be.
Welcome, welcome once again to the Women from the Fire Ministry up here in Billings, Montana. Tonight's topic is power of the communion. The scripture is the Lord's Supper, for I received from the Lord himself that instruction which I pass on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This represents my body, which is offered as a sacrifice for you. Do this in affectionate remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant rectified and established in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, and in affectionate remembrance of me. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are symbolically proclaiming the fact of the Lord's death until he comes again." Tonight's guest speaker is none other than Pastor Rondell Terry of God's Chosen Ministry Incorporated. We're so excited to have him come on. I'm glad this is recorded, because some people said they wouldn't be able to make it. I said, that's the least of your worries when you come to this house, because we record everything. And then we share the good news as God gives it to us up here in media production. Hallelujah. So I'm going to turn it over to the elder himself, pastor, to take it over. I'm going to change this because I'm going to mute myself. And I want everybody just to see him, because when the Lord gave me this, he dropped some things in my spirit, too, about this. And I'm going to make my comments on it as usual. But people, as I'm looking, and I was talking to Evangelist Marlette today, and it's amazing how when God gives those who have an ear the word, and you see what's going on right now, with so much happening right now in the last 2 weeks alone, communion is necessary from the aspect of locking your mind on him, and not on the situations going around. As you do your own look back praise and can stand and know where you come from. Because what's happening now is definitely an assault on the mind. So anyway, I'm gonna turn it over to Elder now, make him the sole speaker, and we're gonna get started.
Thank you so much. I first just like to give honor to God, who was first in my life, and to Apostle as well, and to my wife, and everybody that's on here on the line, and everybody that will hear this sermon or this basically this Bible study tonight. Communion, you know, back in the day when I was younger, you know, when you're in church and you have to do this particular thing, it becomes just, you know, something we do, or you go to a friend's church or a neighbor's church or whatever, and they do this thing we call communion. And in my studies of communion, kind of going more in depth of what communion is and what it means, and because I wanted to find, and I was searching for the power of communion, because God doesn't have us do anything without any power behind it, because he's a God of a power and a God of authority. So I'm going to go ahead and pray before we get started on tonight. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you right now, God, for everything that you're doing in this season, God, for how you're creating in us a clean heart, God, and renewing the right spirit in us right now, God, and giving us back control of those things that we need to have control over in this season, oh God. God, I ask you to renew us, God, with a steadfast spirit, Lord God, within us, God, and do not cast us away, God, or take away your spirit away from us, Lord God. But restore us on tonight, God, as we come together, Lord God, to give you thanks, God. And I ask that you remove me as you come forward with the word, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So tonight, our topic is communion. and we're looking at the power of communion. And if I had a title, it would be Saved from Shallow Religion. And so Jesus says, saves us from sin and shallow religion. We're familiar with communion, the concept of taking communion in the Last Supper in the form of bread and wine and or grape juice for some. The bread representing the body of the bread of life or the body of Christ. John 6:35 says, I believe this is the cup we will receive from Yahshua himself as we enter into heaven. He will hand us a wedding cup. He will hand us a wedding cup. I'm sorry, a little burp there. And say, well done, good and faithful servant. The blood represented cleansing, amongst other things, as we later see in this teaching. See, this is a common practice in most Christian churches today, following a commandment given by Christ himself. These essential elements of the drinking of wine and eating of the unleavened bread were taken from an earlier practice adopted from annual Jewish celebrations to commemorate the Israelites' freedom from captivity and under the Egyptian rule known as the Passover. So communion was also known, again, as the Last Supper. This was the final meal that Jesus shares with his disciples, revealing to us the importance of being in fellowship. And he also emphasizes gathering, us coming together, gathering together and enjoying their meal and ministering to others and bringing other souls to Christ. So it points our hearts forward and to his return to this earth and the establishing of his kingdom. And we see that later on in Revelations. The Last Supper also invites us to participate and to take partnership with Christ in Christ's death. So when we look at the word communion or the Last Supper, it's translated into the word Eucharist or the practice that was taken by the Catholic Church. And this was actually a noun. And it's a sacrament of the Lord's Supper. The communion, the French word was Eucharisté or thanksgiving or gratitude. But I like to look at it in the sense of a verb. Communion is also the act of sharing an intimate relationship with God and other believers. See, we see that in John 5:15, it means a lot more as the scripture would read, I am the vine, ye are the branches, he that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me, you can do nothing. So the word abide means to remain stable or to accept without objection. The word of God says, whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God. And this signifies an intimate relationship versus just a noun of communion. And so the very thought that the Lord God and sinful man are brought together in intimate love and relationship is expressed in the word atonement. Behind this word is the assumption basically that alienation and hostility have been overcome. It also represents reconciliation and forgiveness. There's also, and we can see this in Romans 5:11, it says, so now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God because our Lord Jesus Christ has made us friends of God. So atonement is needed because of the moral corruption of man. And we see this all throughout Romans, the first and first chapter through the third chapter. So the Lord God is holy. He's consecrated or he's spiritually excellent. So God, he's a spiritually excellent God and he cannot look upon sin. So the word atone has the idea to means to wipe out or to erase or to cover. It's often translated to make atonement for or to forgive, to pardon, to purge, to make reconciliation with. The scripture of atonement means that we're looking at was the offering of a bloody sacrifice. See, God is seen providing the sacrifice. And man is performing the ritual or the rite or the event, is being taken part in the event. So when God brought the 12 tribes of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he was delivering them because he loved them and he had a plan for them. So however, at the same time, everything he did for them is a type and shadow of what he has planned for us all. So before he delivered Israel from Egypt, he had them do specific things representing the form that their ultimate deliverance would take. And so we want to look at the power of the blood just for a moment. So to understand the full importance of communion, we need to grasp the understanding of the Passover. So the Passover was a feast, and it was a celebration of the Israelites' freedom from Egyptian captivity, carried about by the covenant God made with the Israelites, versus the covenant that he made with the church. So we see this in Exodus 12 and 7 through 13. It says, then they are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides and tops of the door frame of the houses where they eat the lambs. That same night, they are to eat the meat roasted over the fire along with bitter herbs and bread without yeast. It says, do not eat the meat raw or cooked in water. And the reason for that is because in the Old Testament, if you ate blood, it was still life in the blood. And so God had already told him not to partake in that. And so it says, but roast it over the fire, head, legs, and inner parts. Do not leave any of it till morning. If some of it's left till morning, you must burn it. This is how you are to eat it, with your cloak tucked in into your belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Eat in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. On that same night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, both men and animals, and I will bring judgment. I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. And so what was happening here was God had basically made a covenant that he would protect the Israelites from danger or any harm. And so that verse continues to say, the blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no destructive plagues will touch you when I strike Egypt. And so we know right there that we understand right there the power that's in the blood of the lamb. And so protection, that's one thing that the blood does. And so the blood also heals us from sickness. So from what happened in Egypt in Psalms 105 and 37, it reads, he brought them forth. And this is after they left Egypt. He brought them forth also with silver and gold. And there was not one feeble, which is lacking physical strength, or especially as a result of age or illness, person among their tribes. There was not one sick person among their tribes. And this is after God came through and took care of his business. So God not only covered them in the blood, but he also healed them through the blood. So their physical act of obedience activated the power of God. And that's the important part of that. But God says that not all I want to do. This is not all I want to do for you. So he says, now that I've saved you, I want to have a relationship with you. So I want to invite you to the table so you can get the full benefit of my glory at this table. And at this table, there's four cups of wine and a loaf of unleavened bread. So the cup of it, there's four cups in the Jewish ceremonies. There was actually four cups, even though we only hear that he picks up one. And so you have the cup of sanctification. And this cup represents holiness and the cleansing we need to be able to receive from the Lord. Then you have the second cup, and that's a cup of deliverance. And this cup reminds us of the deliverance of the plagues of Egypt, but it also primarily represents healing from sickness and disease. And then you have the cup of redemption, or the cup of acceptance. And this cup reminds us of the deliverance of plagues of Egypt. Excuse me. It reminds us of being accepted through Christ. So as we go on, I hear the voice of God saying, drink, and I'm going to clean you up, deliver you from sickness and out of the hand of your enemies, and accept you as my own. So all I need from, so God is saying, all I need is for you to praise me. All I need is for you to trust me and be obedient. So this was too much for the Jews, just as it is for some Christians today. So and a lot of times, you know, people will complain about praising God. People will complain about having to have an effective prayer life, but then they want God to do the things that they want God to do, but they only want to give God about 3 hours out of the week, but they want a 24-hour, 365-day God. So I thank you for being a 365-day, 24-hour God. So Paul writes in a letter to the Church of Corinth, talking to them about communion. He says, when we meet together, you get drunk, and no one cares about the poor. You have made communion a big party. He says, you have homes to go live in, so why don't you just go home? it don't make sense for you to come together because you're not really coming together. You're not really in relationship. And so just as the book of Malachi, we see in the book of Malachi and what's going on here by the book of Malachi, they're becoming irritated. They're becoming agitated. They're tired of doing all the sacrifice because in the Old Testament, there was a lot of different steps and levels to atonement. Not only did they have to atone once a year, but they had to atone once a week, once a day. You know, they had to bring sacrifices to the altar, or they had to bring sacrifices to the table. So God says, you basically have taken me as a joke. You're sacrificing blind lamb and lambs that can't walk, but yet and still you want me to show up. He says, but yet and still, he still wanted a relationship with his people, regardless of their actions. And thus, he sends his own son because man couldn't stop sinning. So the old law and the old covenant, it brought death and destruction because we got tired of eating at God's table. See, Jesus says to them, verily, verily, I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. And so I want to talk just a little bit about the power of the bread. So then there was the breaking of the bread in the scripture, which represented his body and how it was broken. And this indicated how Christ's body was broken for us, for the just and the unjust, those who believe and those who don't believe, those who may believe later on in the future. And being put to death in the flesh. And so Paul says we are to die daily to the flesh. And see, Paul was describing an internal battle with the flesh. He says, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from the body of death? And that's in Romans 7 and 24. He says, and if it weren't for God's grace toward us, our flesh would hold us enslaved. And so I begin to see communion as something a little bit different. You know, a lot of times when you get into church and it be all somber and, you know, it made me a little bit emotional. And it's because I continue to put Christ on the cross. And that's what I continue to see, and not the deliverance that came up with that situation that God had in me. You know, because what God was doing was God had an insurance policy that he'd taken out on his son and made us the beneficiaries. God, I thank you. See, God conquers the power of our weakness by setting us free from the flesh. First Colossians 2 and 14 says, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us, he has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. See, God sets us free not only from the penalty of sin, but also from the power that sin has when it remains in us through the activity of our flesh. And so for God sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemns sin in the flesh in order that the righteousness requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the spirit. And that's Romans 8, 3 through 4. See, the word flesh, the word became flesh. And this is in John 1 and 14. In order to be condemned in our place for our sin, and in doing so, paid the full penalty of our guilt. So this was a transaction. And then Jesus gives us his spirit to empower us to walk in newness of life. And this is Romans 6 and 4. So that we no longer are enslaved to cravings or enslaved to our own desires. And our own compulsions of the flesh. And that's in Galatians 5 and 16. And what's happening here is a transformation or a transition that we have happening here. And so Christ is, he's talking about it. He's asking us to remember. But as we remember in other past teachings, that when you remember something, that creates an action in your brain. It creates an action in your heart. And that's why he says, meditate on my word daily. Because we're eating, even though we're not physically taking food, there's still a physical reaction. So that final meal, again, that Jesus shares with his disciples, it was an importance there in that meal. And it was a sharing there, but it wasn't only just them eating that food and sharing it with each other, but it was also basically foretelling what needed to be done and that they need to continue that process. And we can see this later on in Revelations. And this is also how we're keeping ourselves covered and keeping ourselves under the covenant. It's not simply just, you know, eating a piece of bread and drinking some wine. You know, this actually has an effect on our spiritual life, and it's a covenant and a contract that's made. If you have life insurance or any kind of insurance, and you want to be covered under that insurance, you got to pay the premium. So there's certain things that you have to do. There's certain things that have to be done. You can't say, oh, I'm tired of making the payment. And then you get in a car accident and they say, well, you're not covered. And see, that's what happened to some people who think that maybe they're going to make it into heaven when they became lax and when they became complacent with God, as if God is just this pattern of events. We're just going to put him on our schedule for today type of God. So God did not want to send his, in conclusion, God did not want to send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. So God does not want to condemn us, but he wants to save us. So this is a time for us to do an assessment on ourselves. Paul says, examine yourself to make sure that you're in the faith. And this is a time for us to make adjustments during the time of communion. Back to God's way. So, you know, a time for us to reflect and look at ourselves and say, you know, am I really following God's will, or is this my will? So I ask you today, will you practice, you know, giving to more people? Because that's having a mind of Christ. You know, when God blesses us, if we don't have the mind of blessing others, then our blessings may be delayed. So the goal is not for us to do these spiritual exercises and that we can check something off our list, but it's to grow in a self type of giving love, self-giving love, selfishly giving to other people. And that's what God really cares about. He's not keeping score, or he's not working to transform, not working for us to just condemn us. He's working to transform our hearts, and he's working to transform our minds into the likeness of his son. Why? Because he loves himself so much. And he made us in his own image. So why wouldn't he want that closeness and that relationship with us? See, Jesus came to save us from being shallow Christians. So tonight, I want to receive his love and want us to receive his love tonight as we take communion. And I want us to just begin to thank God and just to think on those things that he's already done for us and where he's already brought us from, and just to begin to thank God just on that. If God don't do anything else for us, he's done enough for us. So I thank God for what he has done in my life, how he has changed my life and given me a new life. And, you know, we should always have that newness as Christians, when we're going out and about to our jobs, when we're going to church, there should be excitement when we walk in that church. The Spirit should go before us when we walk into that church. We should never go into the house of God like it's this familiar place and we're expecting something familiar to happen. And so tonight, I don't know if you all have y'all bread and your wine with y'all tonight. And we can come off of mute. But I thank God. So I'm going to read through. We're going to go ahead and have communion now. And do you all, everyone have their bread and their wine? So I just want to say a quick prayer before we do this.
Bless it.
Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word, God. I thank you, Lord God, for the newness of life that you give us day by day, God, as we die in the flesh, Lord God, and as you increase us in the spirit on tonight, Lord God. I ask you right now, God, to help us and guide us and to assist us, Lord God, in examining ourselves, God, that we may become more like you, God, that we may become more of the likeness of you, Lord God, and that that we grow in fellowship with others, Lord God, and that our light shall shine, Lord God, as we go out into the world and as we go out and speak to people and congregate with others, Lord God. I thank you right now, God, for removing our past, Lord God, for removing our past ways, God, and the things that we used to do, God. So we know, God, that you have made us new, God. We thank you, God, that we will not conform to this world, God, but we will be transformed by the renewing of our minds on tonight, God. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. So the word of God says, for I received from the Lord himself that instruction which I pass on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And if you could hold up your bread, if you have it. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this represents my body, which is offered as a sacrifice for you. God, I thank you. Do this in remembrance of me. Eat of the bread. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is a new covenant ratified and established in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it. Affectionate remembrance of me. For every time that you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are symbolically proclaiming the fact of the Lord's death until he comes again. Amen.
Yeah. Well, I want to thank you, Pastor Rondell, for taking the church members through communion. Hallelujah. I want to thank you for the teaching, the in-depth teaching that you did do on this, giving us a history. And I took some notes. First of all, I love the title, Saved from Shallow Religion. And that's the issue with the world. They're in religiosity, aka stupidness. Want to add what they want to the word and do it the way they want to make it look pretty. Let me tell you, being a Christian and walking through with the word, there's a lot of situations that ain't pretty, the things that be happening to us. This is not a ritual, like some people be saying it is. It's not a ceremony. It's not a thing to do. It is a commandment that he gave us to do. Instructions that he gives us to do. Like you said, there's power in everything that God gives us to do. Because like I said, as you do those things, Lord, thank you, Lord. You will feel his presence. I don't care what's going on with you at the time, because as we was preparing the communion and everything else, I heard the Lord speak to me about depression. He was saying, don't even worry about that. This is going to help with it even more. Knock that sucker out. I said, I know that's right. You know, this is something we have to do more of, because it takes our mind off of the things that are going on around us, situations that we feel overwhelmed about, you know, the traumas of life. Because yesterday I was reading an article, matter of fact, I posted on my page about a little girl to the age of 16 was traumatized by her father, who used her in satanic rituals, took her to Freemasons and being used, used her to whoever for sex slave. Now she is a voice for the silence that was traumatized, because they said one of the guys came up and whispered in her ears, until you told your story, I wasn't going to tell mine. And just listening to her talk about it, I was traumatized with what she was doing. I was crying. I felt that we have so many people that have been messed up, not taken care of, protected like they should have been. And they're walking around here wounded, trying to make it the best way they can, because they have not yet developed an in-depth relationship with God. Because as you do it in depth, I don't mean that little skimming service. I mean that in depth when he begins talking to you about things and telling you, letting you know it's not your fault, you need to do this, you're going to have to reach out to this, there is support. But because of the trauma and what people will say to you, people stay in a locked in trauma daily. And it's amazing people haven't just fallen dead. I like how you said it points our heart forward. And it's thanksgiving and gratitude, but sharing. Yeah, you have to have an intimate relationship. And boy, yeah, that moral corruption of man is it. Listen, a blind man can see it and hear it. This world is, oh my God. I liked how you said you broke down the four cups. That was very interesting. That was interesting. You also, I wanted to let you know too, you called out the church again. A rebuke. I thank you again. I was at the house. Okay, Holy Ghost. Because you was calling out the church again. You rebuked them on the ceremony ritual that people are doing for communion. It's like a performance. It's like a show. But they haven't tapped into what the real power of it is. The power of the bread. I love how you broke all that down. Then you're right, killing your flesh daily. You know, but I love insurance policy. Take it out for us. Hallelujah.
Thank you, God.
I was a mute boy. I was like, oh, that's right. An insurance policy taken out for us. And that's right. And you broke it down. You know, people don't pay you. You know, you don't pay on the contract. You on your premium, your insurance, when you need it, it ain't there. That was straightforward. As simple as can be. You don't pay when you need it. And paying is strictly obedience to what God is telling us we must do.
Amen.
We must do. There's no sidestepping. There's no little this, little that. It's a total gut out from the old mindsets that we had built in our lives to protect us until we got to the point with Christ. Now it's time to tell them old bums, y'all got to get a and gut it out, snot some booger it out, whatever it takes. Go before the therapist, find a support group, whatever. Get it done. Because there's so many people waiting on what we have to help them make through. I want to thank you, Pastor Rondell. That was definitely like your apostle. I hit it and quit it, but it had all them mega nugget. Boom, boom. But go ahead.
Amen.
Go ahead. What else? I know y'all want to speak. Somebody say something.
Elder Rondell Terry, thank you so much for it, especially the topic, saved from shallow religion. Because unfortunately, even today, especially most of us who go to church and take communion, we know the significance. It's not just, okay, I'm going to take communion. Okay, here's the bread. Here's the cup. That's it. It's like, within that case, you didn't think of the power and the significance of why we're taking communion. Most of us, most churches do it the first Sunday. Some other churches do it the second Sunday. Some do it in the evening. It don't matter, because the scripture says, do it as often as you eat or drink. You're doing it in remembrance of me, which is Jesus Christ, until he comes. So we're to do it as often. But I feel that people know in our brain, it's always first Sunday or first Sunday evening or second Sunday. It's like that ritual, but never thinking about, hey, we're supposed to examine ourselves, you know, make sure like, hey, you know, we don't want to be considered weak, sickly, and then sleep. I love how you talked about it's a bloody offering of a bloody sacrifice, because of course, if any of us seen the movie The Passion of the Christ by Mel Gibson. Mel Gibson did us a favor. And it's interesting because I had started seminary at the time, really in Masters of Theological Studies. But then it's just interesting coming back, I guess, from break or so forth. I heard those who were in the seminary, oh, that's too much. Oh, I couldn't take it no more. And I believe the fact that we've seen pictures of Christ. We see a little trickle here, a little trickle there. And what Mel Gibson did, it took beyond, I believe he could have took it beyond further. And even the person who played Jesus, he even felt it. It was like, my goodness, just a bloody mess. I mean, Jesus' visions were so marred. I mean, he was barely recognizable. And that what Mel Gibson, The Passion of the Christ, had portrayed. And really, we said he's really laughing to the bank because nobody really wanted to fund this movie. Like, who's going to see something about Jesus? Well, that movie kept playing and playing. And it's just, to me, when I saw it, I was like, oh my goodness. I had a friend next to me. She started crying because it's the effect of, this is what Jesus did for me. The cat of nine tails, the crown of thorns. I just was like, wow, I really felt her emotions. I mean, some people, for me, it's not that I didn't cry. I was moved. I was just so moved by the whole movie from the beginning to the end. Also, you talk about eat in haste. And I'm glad you said that because it talked about in the Corinthians about, you know, are we just doing in haste? Okay, let's hurry up, get it out the way. No, it's the fact that there's a purpose why we eat the bread and we drink the cup. And it shows like that carnality, the Corinthians, it was a bunch of carnality back then. Thank you for sharing the four cups. Apostle mentioned that, so I'm not going to go into that. I like how you talk about there was not one feeble or sick person among the tribe. When I first got saved, when I heard feeble, I just thought like, oh, you got to be old and have a cane. But as growing wiser in the Lord, it's like, oh, feeble mean a sick person. That, you know, no one was sick. Thank you for that 365, 24 hours with God. That should be our lifestyle every day. It shouldn't be, okay, you're driving and you put Jesus on park. You can't put Jesus on park. It's 365, 24 hours. You mentioned that make communion a big party. Unfortunately, people are making it as a big party. And let me see. I like you say, God canceled the power of our weakness. That was key. And I thank you how you said the final meal wasn't about sharing, but foretelling to what to be done. Like, this is supposed to be continued. And if we know about church history, thank God things could have just got lost in the shuffle, but there were those who were willing to sacrifice to be martyr, that we able to partake with what we are partaking today, which is the communion. And it does has an effect on our spiritual life. And thank you so much. Yes, you know, he has saved us from becoming shallow religion, because most of us who are true believers, we know the power of it. I mean, unfortunately, those who are baby Christians that are in churches that's not really teaching the power of communion, it will be shallow. Like, oh, I'm just doing it just to do it. But no, they need to know, what's the significance of the bread and the cup? Why we should do it as often? Why we should not make it a religiosity? Now, like some people say, oh, you got to take it first Sunday or else, or you got to take it fifth Sunday, whatever that day the church have it. But thank you so much for pulling some nuggets that those who look at this video will know the power of it. And they say, hey, thank you, Jesus, for saving us for shallow religion. I yield. Thank you, Rondell Terry.
Thank you.
Good evening, Elder Terry. Good evening, everyone. I really thank you for this study, because what I came to just realize even the more is, going back to what Elder Eileen said, is that we need to do communion more. We really do. It doesn't need to be a set day, because he says as often do this, as is something that we do to remember. And I think a lot of times when we feel like doing it, when we feel like putting it on a schedule, or when we're not properly teaching, then a lot of times people, it's hard for them to remember what Jesus did for them because it's personal. And that's what I got out of it, that communion is something that we do in fellowship, but it's an individual opportunity to just really commune with God and having that divine alignment from my heart straight to his. And so I really thank you for just being able to break down what it means, and that we should do it as often, you know, to remember the death. And it said, because until he comes. So it's remembering that he died for our sins. It's remembering that he died to reconcile us back to God. You know, because we would not have that. We wouldn't have eternal life had he not died. He had to die. And so when we partake in communion, it is that remembrance that he did this just for me. He did this for me. I would not be here, or I would be lost, but he died for me, and it makes it personal. I'm thankful just for you, you know, just talking about the intimate relationship and the reconciliation and forgiveness. And even just going back and giving the understanding of the atonement and what it represented and all of the things that the priest had to do, because that was important. And it really showed, you know, Jesus being the finale for us, that there won't be another after him. And just even a study of the blood. And I just thank you. And I put on here, you know, cross, Christ on the cross versus Christ the deliverer. If he was on the cross and stayed on the cross, we couldn't be delivered. So I am thankful that he is no longer on the cross, because him dying, being put on the cross, but also being ascended with the right to the right hand of God, it shows me that he is Christ, my deliverer, and he has delivered me. And I'm just glad that we got to have communion on a Thursday. It didn't have to be a certain day of the week. It didn't have to be, you know, and these are things that we don't even think about, you know, that not to do it out of tradition, not out of ritual, but understanding what it represents. Just like how we brush our teeth because we don't want to represent bad breath. It's the same thing. It's really the same thing. You know, as often as you remember. So I just thank you for just the study of this word to remember and the transformation and the transition that Christ did just for me.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor Rondell Terry. I really appreciate your word, because communion is a very important part of our life. And I thank God for just opening my eyes to know why I'm taking it and what it means to me. Because as I grow more in Christ, I'm learning that it is sacrificial and I need to do this as often as possible. You know, not just on a day that, like you said, the church wants us to do it on, but like I'm learning that I can do it anytime I'm feeling down, anytime I'm up, anytime I'm going through anything, I can give, you know, thanks to God and I break his body and just drink his blood and be renewed with him. So I'm very grateful for your word. Thank you. I couldn't hear it all because I had a couple of interruptions. But I thank you for this, and I'm going to listen to this after when Apostle posted. Thank you for your word, Rondell.
Thank you.
Amen. And I wanted to say something else. When you were talking about the instructions to roast the meat and not let it go into water, be cooked in water, okay. When you said that, my mind flashed immediately to the water being pierced out of Jesus' side. So that was all the preparation. I was like, wow. But anyway, I want to thank you. You did an outstanding job as usual.
Thank
God as he continues to use you. While others don't want to use you, that's their issue, not mine, because I'll make sure I use the resources around me. See, this is the thing. God gives us all types of resources to get the job done. There Amen. Should be more churches using their resources of leaders in there to preach to the people, because nobody knows it all. Nobody on this side of the world I know knows it all. And it also prepares them, because everybody has the assignment of the people that it's going to assign to you. And I know my crew, wherever y'all go, y'all can represent, because y'all equipped. Because it's like breathing air. You got some people you ask them to do something. Oh, I don't know. Just so you're not trained. You don't feel comfortable. But no, they want to come up with excuses. That's why the boot camp has been established, to allow y'all to have that opportunity, because like I said, our stuff goes around the world. Yeah, all I got to do now is drop this, edit it, post it, and that's that. And y'all just send it out, because whatever's about to happen, we having so many different things happening. God is calling for communion more. That's a wrap.
Father God, in the name of Jesus, God, we thank you for this day that you've made. We thank you, God, for keeping us, Lord God. We thank you for sustaining us, Lord God, with your word, with your substance, Lord God, with food, with oxygen. And God, we thank you so much. And we thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Lord God, we thank you for this word and this Bible study on communion. Yeah. Lord God, we pray that we will always remember who you are, God. Yeah. And that even today, Lord, after we have heard the study, Lord God, we pray, God, that you would just reveal to us what we need to do as it comes to remembering who you are and what Jesus did on the cross for every last one of us. God, we thank you for those that are going to hear this study, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that it is going to give them what they need. It's going to give them understanding. It's going to give them clarity, Lord God. And we thank you, Lord God, for just keeping us, Lord God, keeping the body of Christ, Lord God, in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for your will being done. We thank you for just being a keeper, Lord God. And we ask that this word will just take root, that it be planted, that it grow, Lord God, that it be watered, Lord God, and that so that you can get the increase. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Find another love so kind. One.